thoughts of forgiveness and...
In the state of sleep, or the sleeping mind, or the deceived mind, there's two thought systems, and one is egoic and generates completely unreal thought. The egoic thoughts are very much focused on linear time, on the past and the future. They have nothing to do with the present moment. That's why the planning aspect comes in. It's kind of like a wheel. We kind of call it sometimes the karmic wheel and so forth. And then there are thoughts that spring from love that in the Course in Miracles are referred to as real thoughts. And he says, you have real thoughts, but they're covered over. We could say it's almost like there's a bright core in the mind of real thoughts that are thoughts that we think with God. They're literally extensions of Source. And an example would be, I am as God created me. That's a purely real thought. There's not even a perceptual component or a time component to that. It's kind of reminiscent of Jesus, before Abraham was, I am. Interesting grammar, structure in that sentence, this is I am presence. So there's real thoughts, and then the mind, almost like an onion, is covered with seemingly layers and layers of unreal thoughts. And that's why in meditation, it's often the goal and the practice is to sink down deep into the core of the mind, very deep beneath these unreal thoughts, to touch upon the reality, the real thoughts that are there. So you might even say that our essence is like, we are like a thought in the mind of God, so that we are thunk by our Creator, by our Source. But that's pure abstraction, and then this is a world of specifics that was made up to deny that abstraction, that beingness, we'll call it. And this is very, very specific. So, what is the source of these unreal thoughts? Well, that's the interesting thing, is because they don't have one. The ego is not a real source. I mean, and that's what forgiveness is all about, seeing that if you trace them back, you'll find that there's a core belief or an impossible thought, which we could call, the ego is like an attack thought, the belief that you could pull away from God and have an existence apart from Source, apart from God. The ego is an attack thought, it sponsors other attack thoughts. And that's what most people are aware of, the grievances, the judgments, the daily nagging, the monkey mind, all of that are those unreal thoughts. Now you asked too about feeling. I've actually, when I asked Jesus to give me kind of a diagram of the mind, a map of the mind, you know, he gave me concentric circles, and the core in the center was desire or prayer, and then right outside of that is belief, and the ego itself is a belief. And then right outside of that ring is the realm of cognition or thought, right outside of belief. And then emotions come right outside of the ring of thought or cognition. And then perceptions, the gross perceptual world that is perceived seemingly through consciousness and five senses, is the farthest ring. And everything on the inside is causative, and every ring progressively is an effect of the core. So if the core, which we could call it desire or prayer, if it in any way is tainted, or I guess a word sometimes is defiled, it's kind of like the core is the altar, and if the altar is defiled, then everything that proceeds from that, just like in logic, if you have a false premise, then everything that comes from that false premise is false. The same with the mind. If you have a defiled core, altar, then the belief is tainted with ego, the thoughts are attack thoughts, and the emotions are derivatives of fear. It could be fear, jealousy, envy, guilt, shame, could be a range of fearful emotions, seemingly with different qualities and different names, but actually the same. And then finally, the perceptual world that is perceived through the five senses, that is a result of everything that's underneath it. And ultimately, the ring that's right underneath the gross perceptual world is basically emotions, which is fear. So it's not love that makes this world go around. There's a ring of fear underneath. And Jesus says, you will look upon that which you feel within. So as long as you have fear in your mind, you will see a fearful world. But when you go through a forgiveness process, and that belief is through your prayer and desire, thank heavens there's something deeper than belief, which is where the ego is, through your desire to know God, your desire to be healed, your desire to be whole, then that belief is changed to one of forgiveness. And the thoughts that proceed from forgiveness are the real thoughts. And the emotion is love, and loving emotions, joy, happiness, peace, freedom, so forth. And the perceptual world becomes a happy dream, a forgiven world, a world without judgment. Yeah, like we were talking last night, the quantum field, which everything is energy, everything is completely connected. So it's actually, it was very helpful for me, because when I was like in 7th and 8th grade, I was the one going through, you know, social studies and world histories. I loved maps, and I loved crayons, and I loved to color things. And I was always one saying, can you give me a diagram or a map? And so this is the diagram that Jesus gave me. And when I went through it, I went, aha, oh, it all clicks. It just helped bring everything together. Something like studying psychology for years and philosophy and pondering those things, like what is the relationship to thoughts and feelings and all those things. It was all graphically displayed. So yeah, that just takes us back to your original question, that there is no real source for these unreal thoughts, but there is a belief underneath them, and it's kind of like the plug in the pool that will drain the whole pool if you can get down to it and pull it. And once you're able to see the unreality of the ego, then nothing of the world and nothing of consciousness can be threatening anymore. It's simply been forgiven, or all of its false evidence appearing real has been unplugged from it. And